Welcome to Experience Life Today. I'm Reuben Egolf. Good to be with you here on this Sunday morning. I pray you've had a blessed week. And I pray today in this next hour, you're going to even get more blessed, not because of me or anybody else, but because of the Holy Spirit exalting Christ through His word and message. We have a message today called Dying to Self. And I want to tell you the most important understanding and then to implement it in the life is this, is to die to ourselves and let Christ arise in our life. I'll get this out in just a moment. You stay with me. But to let Christ arise in our lives, and when we die to ourselves, it gives Him the opportunity to shine bright through us. And that is the main thing of the main thing in Christianity is dying to ourselves. Now, I want to bring something to you before we get into the message today. We received a letter from a dear friend and supporter of this program here in the local area, made mention of something. It really was on our minds, but we just never explored it anymore. And the suggestion has been, would you consider, meaning to me, in Experience Life Today, would you consider having a partner meeting sometime? And, you know, I'm all for that. It would be great. It's not an expense to you or anything like that, but we would do something to just to say our thanks to you and your support. I want you to pray about this. I'd love to do that. Maybe we could meet somewhere. We try to find a central location. It might be hard for the four states. It may wind up in Hagerstown, Maryland. Might be the best we could do because I know we have friends in Frederick. We have people all the way down in towards Culpeper, Virginia, and folks out there in West Virginia, out through the Panhandle, Martinsburg, but then all the way out into, Cabins, West Virginia, and out into those areas, and what's that other place out there? I want to say Columbia, but that's not it. But out there in Maryland, all over. So to go one direction or the other, I don't know, maybe Hagerstown would be probably the best and feasible. But anyway, be that as it may, would you pray about that? And maybe we can put something together, meet in some sort of a conference room in a motel somewhere in the Hagerstown area or somewhere. If you have suggestions, write it in, whatever. We're open to that. Be more conducive for more people to come. And we could have a partner meeting, maybe have a meal, and I could speak a few words, and you get to know you in a personal way, and you get to know us and the board and my wife and so forth, and it'd be a great time. So we'll talk more about it if you would be interested in it. Could we hear from you? Write to us. Write in, whether it's by the post office. You can email us, say, look, you know what? I'd be seriously interested in that. Maybe we can be coming up with something in the fall. I don't know. I don't want to make any promises. I do know my schedule is really filling up throughout portion, especially in November, is really getting full. But be that as it may, we'll work together on it, okay? Wouldn't that be a great idea? Now go ahead and shake your head. Yes. Don't spill your coffee. Sip your orange juice, okay? Now, some other things we wanted to discuss with you also before we get into this message. Be praying. Also hear about the financial end here in Experience Life Today. In the next newsletter, I've been telling you, look, I'm going to bring this to you. In the next newsletter, I'm going to segment one of the segments. I'm going to talk about the finances of Experience Life Today. So be looking for that. The next newsletter, I'll be discussing that. Our financial situation here for the rest of the year, where we are presently in the bank and et cetera, and what is needed for the rest of the year to tie it out and get started for 2016. I'll be doing that and discussing it, okay? I want to thank you, those of you that so precious, so committed to financially supporting this ministry. You're the reason why we can say to people it is 100% viewer supported. And with that, even my wife and I, Lacey and I, we don't just leave it to other people. We invest in this ministry in many capacities. My wife, she burns the midnight oil in editing. She's the one that edits this program from beginning to end. She burns the midnight oil in doing that sometimes. She gets glitches, and sometimes it's midnight, so, I'm having a problem here, and the oils are burning. Whether it's us doing those sorts of things, ministering here at the church, all of that, praying for you as viewers, all of these things goes into that. We don't draw a dime from this ministry. We don't take money from this ministry and go buy a car. We don't go and, for goodness sake, we don't buy a jet. We don't have the money to do any of all of that kind of stuff. We have no interest in doing that. We want this ministry to be supported, viewership, ourselves, and be able to go forward in it and get the gospel out, okay? So be looking for the very next newsletter. We'll take care of those questions you may have that you can see, okay, well, maybe I can pinpoint here. Those of you that have not given, we do not do any high-pressure sales. We don't come up with any schemes and scams, none of that. We try to do it biblically, and the Bible is clear. You are not to feel forced to give. You are not to feel compelled. You're not to feel guilty. I'm not to put a guilt trip on you. I'm not to come up with some finagling of something to trick you into giving. I'm not doing it. I don't have the time to do it. I don't care to do it. I want it to be biblical. Here is what I will say. Does Experience Life Today have needs? Yes. We have a monthly bill that has to be paid all the time, all 12 months. We have a contract that comes up in December, and there it is. And when that contract's signed, we're locked in for the next year, and it's by faith. We have other things as well that goes into the upkeep and cameras and other things that are cost, not a lot, but there is extra cost beyond our payment for television. And so all I'm asking you is this, and I assure you, it's not going in my pocket, it's not padding my pocket, it's not buying me cars, it doesn't buy me anything else. It goes right into this ministry, okay? All I'm asking you to do is this, pray about it first. No knee-jerk reaction. You pray about it. Take a couple days, pray about it. God, should I sow into Experience Life Today? Should I give into that? You let the Spirit bear witness with you, and then you obey whatever the Spirit says. If He doesn't say no, no, well then whatever. But if He says yes, then obey it. Ask God, is this good ground? I'm not going to trump and pat myself on the back, do anything like it. You ask God, He knows. You ask God, is this good soil to plant my financial seed into? When God brings the answer back, don't do anything until you get the answer back from God. And then you do whatever God says. Then you can sow into it, and then you can get your harvest back. You'll get a financial reward back because you're sowing financially, you reap financially. And you'll also be a part in souls being won, people being healed, and the whole thing, all of this, you become attached to this ministry. And I'll tell you, I pray great blessings on you. Whether you give or not, I pray you be blessed. Let's go. Let's die to self. Look at Matthew here this morning. I took you up here, but I'll be there in just a moment. I want you to go to Matthew chapter 7 and verses 12, 13, and 14. I was on this a Sunday night a week ago on verse 12 and ministered basically on the golden rule. You're going to be hearing about that on this coming Wednesday night. But I want to reread this and then carry it on. This is not going to be popular this morning. This message is not going to have us dancing in the aisles. Nobody's going to be hanging off of chandeliers, and nobody is going to be there clapping and cheering the message along. But it is a very necessary message. And it is an important one for the hour. And I even almost hesitate giving you the title, because when I give you the title, it gives it away. And immediately you won't want to shout amen. But I'm going to say it anyway. Is that all right? Three words. And here's the title, Dying to Self. Boy, your enthusiasm almost knocked me over right there. You know, it's not enthusiastic when you hear about this, but I will tell you something. Dying to self is the key that unlocks the door of every blessing God has for your life. Do you know that? You'll learn it as we go. And here we go. In verse 12, we can all read together. It's King James Version, but whatever you have, we'll all end up in the right place. Are you ready? Therefore, Jesus speaking, all things whatsoever you would that men should do to you, do you even so to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Come on, somebody. Somebody else say amen to that one.
And we learned Sunday night a week ago that if this little rule, one verse, be followed, it literally, one verse, would erase, eradicate, obliterate every single problem out of every church and even their community if everybody obeyed this one verse. Do you know why? Because nobody would lie on their neighbor. Nobody would gossip about their neighbor, their brothers or sisters or anybody in the Lord. Do you know that a church that truly believes this verse will not talk down about one another to anybody else? Did you know that? Do you know why? Because you don't like it when they do it to you. So if you don't want treated, if I don't want treated that way, then I won't do it to them. So I told you it's not going to be too exciting, but just wait. Verses 13 and 14. And then it's interesting. After Jesus says this, he kicks right into verses 13 and 14, and there's reason for it. Let's read it in his famous verses as well. Ready? Enter ye in at the what? Notice that is not straight for us Greencastleites. Okay. That's not straight. Doesn't mean that it's in a straight line. That's not what that word is. Straight there is S-T-R-A. We learned this in history class, the Strait of Magellan and all those kinds of things. And what that means is that it is a very narrow passageway. It is a compressed area, okay? So you enter in at the straight gate. It's a very small, very tiny. It is a very compressed area. I wasn't going here, but just to refresh your mind, that historically speaking, that inside of the main gates of every city, generally speaking, they were huge. They were not little gates or doors like we have here at the church or any at your house, but they were huge gates. But in those gates, built into them was a very tiny door. And that door was for a purpose, and that is at sundown, the huge gates would swing shut and were barred shut and locked for because of invading whatever or marauders or bands of people that would come and thieve that lived out there in the desert, so to speak. But there was a tiny door there for one reason, and if you were traveling, instead of leaving you outside and at the mercy of the marauding bands of thieves and pillagers and all of those that would destroy you or maybe even murder you, they would give you access to the city. However, the little door was that small that a camel, literally, believe it or not, a camel could not walk through it with all its wares. It actually had to crawl through it, and they could do that. Now, it's amazing, but they could do it. And so what happened is that when you came to that straight gate, with that little door, at night you'd knock and look, and the doorkeeper was there, and he would find out, and he would do a little questionnaire and find out and believe who you are, and then he would open the door, and the only way you could walk in is you had to take all of your baggage off the camel, off yourself, and then you could get through that compressed area. And it is alluding to that when you come to Christ, all of the baggage of sin has to come off, and then you enter into that straight gate. Is that making any sense? All right. Now, let's read on. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And notice how many's going there. And many there be which go in thereat. That means majority. Not just many, but that word in the Greek is majority. That most people are going the wrong direction. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life. And what's that next word? Few. That means a very extreme minority. In the Greek, actually, that word is where we get the word puny. Very, very, very small amount of people that find it. Not that Jesus doesn't want very many people going to heaven. It's just that the qualifications, man is so rebellious, he does not want to go in the way of the Lord. Now, when you look at this, at this entering in at the straight gate, he is basically referring back verse 12, which is interesting, this golden rule of verse 12. And he's talking back that this strict observant, and you say, that's right, and we're Christians, and we're believers, and we're on our way to heaven. However, if we are believers, first base, as we learned a week ago, is that we should be observing the golden rule in our life. In other words, everything that we do the first decision we make is based on this. How would I want to be treated? And that's how I respond, act, talk, and think according to an interaction with that person. Is everybody with me so far? If I'm not doing that, I'm violating the ABCs of Christianity, and I'm violating, and this is why it is such a strict path and such a straight and compressed area. It's not easy to just treat people the way you want to be treated. If it was, everybody would be doing it. Every church would be doing it. Every church would have no division in it. So everybody that says the Lord is their Lord means He owns them, is truly not their owner. He is our owner when we are doing what He says. Am I telling the truth? All right, so this is the key. Now, I'm all for, you know, charismatic and Pentecostal, and I'm all for showing exuberance. I think there ought to be demonstration. I think we ought to be emotional. I don't mind people getting loud. Amen. You know, if you can get loud at a ball game, come to church, and as soon as somebody says, amen, shh, amen, just sit there and be quiet. Quiet in the church. Well, I think we can be, listen, if I'm emotional about Pittsburgh going across the TD line, and I do get emotional, my wife will tell you. Matter of fact, you don't even want it in the living room if they're losing. But anyhow, I even have a football that's foam that I can throw at the television if it gets too bad with Ben. And so anyhow, I pray for his salvation every day. And they're going, and I get excited. But I want to tell you something. I ought to show more excitement when Jesus comes into my mind, because He is the one who saved me. Right? Now, I'm all for emotional, but let me tell you something. Jumping and shouting and singing loud and shouting hallelujah and amen, raising hands, all of that is wonderful and good, but that doesn't mean anything if I can't treat my neighbor the way I want to be treated. See, God looks on the heart. He doesn't just always get excited because we're just jumping around. He gets excited when the rubber hits the road on Tuesday morning when somebody cusses you out and you didn't cuss them back. Boy, it's just getting quieter and quieter, isn't it? You see, this is the ABCs of Christianity. Now, dying to self. Boy, here we go. And when Jesus up on the wall here in Luke 9:23, and I'm going to jump back here in just a moment, but he says, and he said to them, now he's speaking to his disciples at this moment, but I want you to put yourself in the room with Jesus this day. In the setting of Luke chapter 9, it's in others in Matthew and Mark as well. I want you to see, and I want you to put yourself, you are here in the room with Jesus when he says this. And you're not an American, no matter what your ethnicity or race or whatever else, but you are a Jew this morning. You are a Jewish, you are Jew and Israelite, and you're sitting in the presence of Jesus Christ. And he says to you, and he said to them all, if any man, any of you, will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Now you're sitting in this congregation just like myself, and we are an American and we're sitting here, and when somebody says that, we hardly feel little about the ramifications of that. However, when he said this to them, and I'll bring it to your speed in just a moment, when he said that to them, you could have heard a pin drop in that room or wherever they was at that point. If he would have been standing in the middle of 1,000 Jews that day in Jerusalem and would have said these words, they could have been loud, boisterous, they could have been talking amongst themselves, disengaged, couldn't have cared less. But the moment he said, take up your cross, at that moment there would have been a hush and the silence would have been deafening. And you say, why? What's the big deal? Because in that day, and don't get condemned about this, doesn't meant to be condemned. We understand why we wear crosses around our necks, or you have rings, or you have bracelets, or you have something. And so don't get condemned. But I will tell you, a Jew would have never wore a cross around their neck. And now don't get condemned about that. Don't, you know, oh, what's it? I'm not preaching against wearing cross. I'm just telling you. Why? Because how many of us would wear an electric chair symbol around our neck? Nobody. You know why? Because the symbol that you get with the electric chair here in America, and when you think of that kind of punishment, immediately, now let's rephrase it. What if Jesus would have said to an American audience, and he came to you and said, let everybody take up your electric chair and follow me. Now you get a different reaction. Now even an American audience goes, what? What did he just say? Because the cross to the Jew was the same thing as an electric chair to an American mind. Because to them, they understood what the Romans had done to them, and their landscape was dotted with crosses. Most of these Jews, their families or relatives, their friends, their neighbors, their community, most of them had somebody they were in relationship with that died on a cross. The Romans were, as time went on, the worse they got in persecuting the Jews. It became unbelievable. As a matter of fact, at one point in Jewish history, at about 70 AD or so forth, at one point in their history, it got so bad, they were literally running out of crosses. They couldn't keep up the cross making to keep up with how many were slated to die on the cross. Now let that speak to you for a minute. And Jesus comes by and he says to the Jewish mind, I want you to pick up your cross and follow me. And you would say, well, I want you to pick up your electric chair and follow me. What does that symbolize to you? And I'll tell you one thing is, it means death to that individual. Am I right? I'll tell you something else it means. Jesus was saying, I'm not after a casual, a little bit of enthusiasm. I'm not after a little bit of a crowd applause in following me. That isn't following me. If you're going to follow me, you're going to have to die, and it's going to cost you a little bit of pain, but if you're going to have to die in order to follow me in this life and to the life beyond. Can I hear an amen on this? And this is where the rubber hits the road. You see, because in the American mindset, in following Jesus means that the windows of heaven open up and they can't. Oh, yeah. But listen, here's where the problem comes, that we feel when we get saved, now there's not another problem, and we're going to get rich, get a mansion, 3 Rolls Royces, and if anything happens, we must not be operating in faith. And that is not true at all. Following Christ is going to cost you some things in this life. And let me tell you what triumphs. What is going to get you through the pain is when you love Christ more than yourself. I know nobody's going to leave here today and say, boy, I tell you, I just love that message. I want to tell you something, but this message will change your life if you do. There's a lot of things coming. And you say, what does it look like? You're going to hear this after a while. You're going to hear what a true crucified life really looks like. But you have to give me some time to get there. You see, this is not about, Jesus was established in faith. This is a Sermon on the Mount. Here in 5, 6, and 7 in Matthew is the Sermon on the Mount when he's talking about straight as the gate. He is establishing right away. And then on in Luke chapter 9, he's establishing this kingdom. You don't just sign up on a membership card and everything's all right. No, he said, this will cost you your life. You're going to have to die for me to live and actually gain access to this kingdom. Okay, now let's take it a little bit further. I'll give you some stories here and then I'll move into more scriptures. And Cyrus, how many remember Cyrus in the Bible? Does anybody remember Cyrus? Daniel was one point. There was other portions of scripture. Cyrus, the Persian, actually was noted as the founder of the Persian Empire. And he eclipsed the Medo Empire with King Darius and those. You remember those stories as well. And this was a story. He had captured a prince in his family. And it was interesting. When they came before the monarch, they was basically King Cyrus was going to have him killed. And he asked the prince, the prisoner, he said, what will you give me if I release you? What will you give me if I release you? And he said, the prince, the captured fellow said, I tell you what, I will give you the half of my wealth. Then the King Cyrus said, if I release your children, what will you give me? The prince said, I will give you everything that I possess. Then King Cyrus said, if I release your wife, what will you give me? And the prince said, your majesty, O king, I will give you myself. And as they were leaving, and Cyrus was so moved by this devotion of the husband and the father of the children, and he was so moved by it that history records that he freed the whole family and said, go on your way. And as they were returning home, the prince said to his wife, and he couldn't take it any longer, and he said, I was kind of taken back, and he looked at his wife and said, my honey, he said, wasn't Cyrus a handsome man? And with a long, deep look of love towards her husband, she said these words. She said, honey, she said, I didn't notice how handsome he was. She said, I could only keep my eyes on you, the one who was willing to give his life for me. Some of you didn't even get that, but I'm going to tell you something. When we fall in love, this one gave his life for us. I don't care how handsome the devil gets. I don't care how beautiful temptation gets. But when you really think about this one gave everything for you, you won't even give that a second glance. 10 more got it there. Amen. I want to tell you how people fall into temptation is that they lose the concept of what this one did for them. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, I'll take it a little bit further. A woman was carrying, this is another recorded thing, and I don't know how this happened. I just know that this was, and I read this, and a woman was carrying her back. Can't even give you the year that it happened. But she was carrying a baby on her back. I don't know if it was pioneered. I don't know. But she was trapped by a prairie fire. As she looked about, she realized there was no way of escape. And the records show that she actually took her hands. She had no tools, no shovel, no pick, nothing. And quickly, she began to dig with her hands in the dirt there in the prairie. She dug a hole, and as she was surrounded by the fire, laid the baby down inside that earth with her bare hands, and she placed her child in it and covered the child with her body. When they got the fire and got into her, she had succumbed to the smoke and literally was partially burned, but immediately they pulled her off, and the baby was alive. Now, that's what Jesus did for us. You hearing what I'm saying? Let this be known how much Christ gave for us. Now, I'm going to back up and show you some things in Galatians chapter 2:20. Let's read it together. I am what? Crucified with Christ. All right, put it in American mind. I have been electrocuted, I should say. I have been killed. I've been destroyed. I'm dead. I'm crucified with Christ. Let's read on. Nevertheless, what? I live. Aren't you glad for life? Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. What does that mean? That's not a cliche. That's how we say that. Well, Christ lives in me. What does that mean? If Christ lives in me, that means his nature, and nature spawns action. And that means his actions is living through me. I'm not living for me, and I'm not living as me. I'm living as Christ. Am I telling the truth? All right. That's why we don't lie. All right. Liveth in me and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me. Listen to that. He brings our mind back. He says, when the going gets tough, think about this, who loved me and gave himself for me. Let that encourage me. If Christ died for me, can I not endure some things in this life for him? Okay, all right. Now, and he'll supply. So what does that mean? Dying to self is important for living for Christ. You must, and I must, be dead to self. It's important for living for Christ. If I don't, I don't live for him. Now, in 9:23, we're already quoted this, and he said to them, oh, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. And to follow Christ requires death to self. If I'm not dead to myself, I can't follow Christ. I'm too busy following me. And then when you get up to Galatians 5:24, and they that are Christ have done what? Crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Now, he says, they that are Christ. What's that mean? Death to self identifies you and me with Christ. So if I'm dead, he's alive in me, then I'm identified now as a Christian. What does Christian mean? Christ-like. Well, I know Christians on the job. I know Christians on the job, and they go to church every Sunday. Well, there's more to the qualifications of being a Christian than going to church. Amen. I mean, we park a car in a garage every day, and it never become, you know, but anyway. Me just going out in the garage doesn't turn me into a car, am I right? Why some of you look at me? I mean, do I look like I have a bumper or something? But anyway, you see, just going somewhere doesn't do that. You know people on the job, and they, oh, I go to church. Oh, I'm faith. I'm there every Sunday morning. But yet, they lie on everybody else. They gossip about everybody else. They have unforgiveness in their heart. They spew venom every other hour. I mean, they're this and they're that, and they live life like the devil. Let me tell you something. If I live like the devil, then I'm of the devil's crowd. I'm to live like Christ, which is not living like the devil. Okay. Okay. Mark, I didn't write this. He wrote it. He said, if they are Christ, they have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. What else? Mark 8:35. Ready? For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake in the Gospels, the same shall save it. It's necessary to truly experience everlasting life. I can't have it without death to self. One more here. Romans 6:1-2. Oh, this is a killer. Ready? Let's read this one. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? What God say? God forbid. How shall we that are live any longer therein? I didn't write this. He did. God, Holy Spirit inspired Paul to write this. Death to self means what? It means separation from sin and its function. Sin has a function, just like righteousness has a function, okay? Now, let me get this, and you're going to have to fasten your seatbelt in just about 5 minutes, so just give me a little bit more time. I got to build this foundation, and we're going to launch into this. The essence of a being's existence has to do with the fact that he's a living reality. I got this written down. If one no longer has the functions of vitality, they are said to no longer exist. So the essence of death is what? The absence of life. Therefore, when one dies, one ceases to exist in this sense, in this side. To carry the argument into the spiritual realm, when someone spiritually dies to self, that means self ceases to exist. That is, self is no longer the reason for someone's existence. That's telling me when I'm dead to myself, I no longer live. I don't live for me. That's not the reason for my living, is for me. My reason now to live is for the one who died for me. What he wants, not what I want. Am I right? When a temptation or feeling erupts inside of me or a thought in my mind that violates what he wants, what am I to do? The Bible says you are to mortify it. What's the word mortify? That doesn't mean getting scared. Mortified means you slay it, you kill it. How do you kill it? You don't listen. This is where temptation turns into a problem. Temptation, you'll never stop in your life. A thought that comes in your mind that violates the word of God doesn't mean you're going to hell. Okay, nothing like that. That is a temptation. How do you keep it from turning into something into your life? Okay, you don't meditate on it. Meditation is another word for fermentation. Meditation means it takes something and ferments it. What happens when something is fermented? When you partake of something fermented, you come under its influence. What do we call somebody who is drunk? Oh my, they're under the influence. Under the influence of what? The alcohol, which is what? Has fermented, okay? So somebody who is doing sin, they meditate. That is what they think on, so that is what they are. How many knows when you think on the word? What do? We meditate on the word. Why? When you meditate on what God says, you are fermenting the word in your heart, and what is going on? You're now under the influence of the word and not of the world. Is this making sense to anybody? You see, this is so simple. It is simple. It is not hard to live the Christian life in the sense of doing it God's way. We simply have to apply it and not take the excuse of like being jellyfish on the sea and, well, I just can't help myself. Oh, yes, we can. We are given decisions. This Bible's full of decisions. When you make a decision to this word, you get the consequences of the word. And he says, if your mind is stayed on thee, him will I keep in perfect peace. That means if I'm agitated, irritated, I am meditating and fermenting on the wrong thing. What happens when you meet somebody in the supermarket and you say, how you doing? And 30 minutes later, they are still telling you the grocery list of all of their ailments. That's what their mind's on. When you tell them, listen, when you tell them, well, I tell you what, I believe in the healing power of God, and their eyes glaze over and say, yeah, I do too. No, they don't. No, they don't. What they believe is everything's been told them, and now they're using that for whatever the other, prostituting for other pity and everything else. Listen, people gravitate to that and say, well, how you doing? And you say, well, what am I to do? I understand. I have problems. We all have physical issues that comes our way. But, we don't have to meditate on the problem. Why not meditate on the solution? Did anybody say amen to that? Okay. Let's meditate on the solution a little bit. Now, the individual who dies to self understands that God created him for a reason. That I'm a part, you're a part of God's plan. That means if I don't die to myself, I'll live for myself and I abort the plan of God in my life. A person who truly dies to themselves, understand God has a plan for your life and he can only use us if we literally die to ourselves and yield to him. Am I telling the truth? All right. Now, oh boy, what does dying to self really, really look like? Are you ready for a vivid picture of what it looks like? Are you ready? Is your seatbelts fastened? Do you have your steel toes on? Nudge your neighbor now. Don't nudge him when I'm talking about it because somebody will see you, all right? So you get ready. Now you look at him. You even look at him and say, look, I know what he's about to say is going to be for you. I don't know about me, but it's going to be for you, all right? I'm telling you, this is for you. Now, what does it really look like? Boy, I tell you, if God gets a church like this, look out. Are you ready? When you are forgotten, when people forget you, when you are neglected, when you are purposely devalued and considered, in your opinion, as nothing, and you don't sting with hurt because of the oversight, but your heart is really happy because the word comes to your mind that you've been counted worthy to be suffering for Christ. That, number one, and I've got a bunch more coming, is dying to self. How many people do you run into and the first words when they're talking about somebody, well, you don't know what they did to me. Dying to self says, I'm going to forget what they did for me or did to me. Amen? Let's really relive this gospel. You ready for number two? When your good is evil spoken of. How many has ever had that happen? How many is when you said something, somebody twisted around and said something else about it, wasn't what you said? When your good is evil spoken of, when your wishes are crossed, your advice is disregarded, your opinions are ridiculed. Has anybody ever had your opinions ridiculed and made fun of? Three of you have. The rest of you might be lying. I don't know. But your opinions ridiculed and you refuse. How many knows the temptation is there to do what? I tell you what, they ain't going to treat me this way. That's a temptation. But you don't have to react to the temptation. We can react according to the Bible. Amen? Thank you for one amen. And you refuse to let anger rise in your heart or even defend yourself, but you take it in patience and in loving silence. That is dying to self. Boy, it's quiet. Is that, huh? Do you know what's wrong? You know, the world, we could win more of the people of the world if we simply acted the basics of Christianity. Oh, here comes one. This goes against the goal in America. When you, no, that's the next one. I'm going to go in line. When you lovingly and patiently put up with, bear with any disorder, any irregularity in your life, any annoyance, anything that would try to irritate, when you can stand face to face with extravagance and spiritual insensibility, and you can endure it as Jesus did, that's dying to self. Oh, it just irritates me. Oh, I can't take it. Oh, yes, we can. We're just deciding not to. Amen. It's a choice. It is a choice. It's a choice. Listen, don't give people that kind of power over you. Amen. You don't know what they said. Don't give them that kind of power. Let God's word have more power than what they say. Oh, well, I'm glad you came to church this morning. Even if you didn't, we're coming back tonight, Lord willing, and we'll catch you then, okay? Now, here's one for America. Listen to this. Boy, dying to self means that we become content. You know what content is? We're satisfied. When we become content with any food, any salary, any clothing, any time, any kind of climate, whether it's hot or cold, any, oh boy, I got some, I ain't going to that church. Why? Too hot. I ain't going to that church. Why? Seats are too hard. You know, it's amazing to me. It is amazing to me. This is how the church, I mean, we're convenience driven. We might as well admit it. I mean, if it gets out of sorts, we just can't be content. But you know, it's amazing to me. People complain about church climate and seating, and yet, back to football, December middle, let's get back to Pittsburgh, how about it? And back out there, and it's 20 degrees, wind blowing, and people sitting on, are they not? Hard seats, cold. And they're there. Oh, are you excited to be here? Oh, my, just love it here, out here at Heinz Field. Oh, it's cold, don't you? Oh, we don't care about that. Bring on the hot dogs. In church, padded seat. I mean, that's padded. Climate in here is usually all right. It's, you know, probably around 70 degrees. And I mean, and plenty of lighting. And in the snow, there's no snow in here. No wind in here. Unless somebody's blowing hot air on you, just tell them to keep it closed, all right? I mean, nothing in here. No fumes in here. I mean, people go to NASCAR. I mean, again, nothing wrong with these things, but I mean, they're there. Yeah, go on, Dale. Wow. I mean, just, I mean, and they'll come to church. Same people come to church. Boy, I thought, I can't take it in this place. Sit out there in a ball game, a blazing sun, baseball in the middle of July. Boy, just sweat, just running. Whoa! Why is it that amusements will die for that? We got quiet there. We'll die for that, but we can't die for the one who really saved us. See, when we're content, listen, we learned this on the mission field even. I mean, you know, sometimes you can hit financial hard times. Everybody in here probably at one point hit financial hard times, and maybe you're currently in it, but in the past you did. And how many knows that when you hit hard times, you can't eat filet mignon? And you may have to come up with all kinds of ways on how to make a meal for you and the kids out of hot dogs and macaroni and cheese. And how many say ate that? I mean, you've had it chopped up and you put it in the macaroni and cheese and now it's whatever you call it. And this and that. I mean, just on and on and on. But you know, but instead of complaining and perpetuating the problem, you keep looking ahead and knowing that in no matter what, I'm saved and I'm on my way to heaven. And if that means I got to eat hot dogs and macaroni and cheese now, there's coming a day I won't eat hot dogs and macaroni and cheese. Amen. That, you know what the world needs to see? Even when somebody's eating hot dogs and macaroni and cheese, the world needs to see that instead of a complaining mouth saying, you know what, I'm glad and thankful we have something to eat. These old hot dogs and macaroni and cheese. That's acting like the world. You know, we have to act different than the world. That's them complaining about it, but we're thankful. We're thankful we have something. Here comes. Dying to, what does it look like? We got to find out. What does it look like? When we never care to refer to ourselves in conversation, or record our own good works, or itch after commendation, when you can truly love to be unknown, that is dying to self. Isn't it wonderful that when we get to a point, it doesn't matter if we're in the limelight or not, all that matters to us is He being lifted up. And this man that's coming on Wednesday night, I got to share this with you. And I'm going to share something on Wednesday night. He said something, and I won't say it now, but there's something else. And I was thinking yesterday, I mean, I can't believe in seeing, and it's a shame I say it like that. I can't believe. It's amazing when you see people, and many of you in there, so it's not a, but to see people that are so rare, but yet they're living the Christian life. That shouldn't be a rarity in America, but it is. I am so amazed. We was in this phone call, and things that he has opened doors for your pastor. Oh, but he didn't have to do that. I didn't ask him to do it. Never one time said, hey, he says to me, and he told me, even like yesterday, and he said, Reuben, he's opening this door, and I mean, it's amazing. He's using his diplomatic power and authority, and I didn't ask him. He said, Reuben, I feel God has called you here and doing this and speaking, and he said, and the door is wide open, and he's doing it. And what is amazing to me is this. Very rarely at that high of a level do you find people willing to sacrifice themselves to promote somebody else. Usually what you run into is jealousy.
Amen.
Well, he ain't getting ahead of me, I'll tell you that. And if you start getting ahead of somebody, they'll start talking you down so to put you behind them. I mean, it's so rare. When I thought about it, I thought to myself, yeah, I thought, doctor, this is amazing. I mean, so selflessly, doesn't care. All he cares about is let's have Christ exalted. Doesn't matter whose vessel, we're just caring about the kingdom progressing. Whew, jealousy is cruel as the grave. I mean, when we start thinking these thoughts, who does he or she think they are? We've got a problem. Maybe they don't think anything. Where are we at? I'm losing my way here. When you, oh, here it comes. Just hang on. I told you to fast. If you're falling out of your seat, I told you and warned you. When you can see your brother prosper and have, and let me tell you, not just a brother in the Lord, even a physical brother biologically. Boy, a lot of division in families. I see this as a minister, and I'm not speaking in this church, but outside the church even, and stuff, and I get called for doing other things in ministry, and I'm amazed. I'm amazed at the division in families, and it's brutal. And you know where it all starts? Just jealousy. Just jealousy. Somebody got a bigger house, and they'll go to their grave hating one another over something so stupid. Now listen, when you can see your brother prosper and have his needs met, and we can honestly rejoice with him, not only on the outside. You know, everybody can fake it. I mean, that's a mantra today. Fake it till you make it. No, don't fake it all. Just be real. When I can honestly rejoice with that person in spirit and feel no envy, no jealousy, nor question God. Because people do that. Why is God blessing them the way I've served him all these years? I remind you of the prodigal son and his brother. Remember the brother? Remember the one we don't talk about? Because we don't like to talk about him. We like the prodigal son. Oh, he come out. Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah, but what about the other old boy? Because that typifies too much of Christianity. Jealous over somebody getting blessed and having some party thrown for him. And well, I've served you all of these years, and I didn't get no fatted calf killed for me. I mean, this is terrible. No one terrible. The father said, listen, he lost his third. You still have yours, and all that is mine is yours. You're ever with me. What are you complaining about? The story ends right there. It might have been like, you know, back in the Old Testament with the great prophet Jonah complaining at the very end. I mean, it's amazing. But you see, listen, I'll say it again. When you see your brother prosper, have his needs met, can honestly rejoice with him in spirit and feel no jealousy, you don't question God, while your own needs are far greater and you are in current desperate circumstances. Well, I didn't get one amen on that. See the temptation? God must have forgotten. God didn't forget about anybody. Your time will come. And then they should rejoice when you're blessed. Right? Pastor, hurry up with this message. I'm done. I got to go eat chicken. No, just wait now. Just wait. Well, here comes. It don't get any better. When I say you, but it's all of us, me. When we, this is dying to self. When we can receive correction. Let's go ahead and cough now because this is getting out of our throats. All right. When we can receive correction and reproof from one of less stature, position than ourselves. And we can humbly submit inwardly as well as outwardly. You see, you can do it, fake it again outwardly. You know, little children do that. How about it? Go clean your room. And they'll go clean it, but boy, inside they ain't clean it. Amen. You know what I'm saying? But God wants it inwardly as well as outwardly, right? Okay, now, humbly, so inwardly as well as outwardly, finding no rebellion or resentment rising up within the heart. That is truly dying to self. Because the first temptation comes is, who are you to tell me what to do? And we get the old head going, you know. If they're right, they're right. Receive it. I'm better if I respond to correction than if I ignore it. Correction is for a purpose. It is to benefit me and you. Am I right? Why do we correct a child? It's to benefit the child. But the child in the rebellious state will think, you're out to hurt me. No, I'm out to help you. I know when I was growing up, I thought that was the weirdest thing until I came to that understanding. I thought it was the weirdest thing that my mother and father would beat my rear end. Oh, don't say that today. You can't whip a child's hind end today because you'll warp their personality. That's what they say. I like what old Evangelist Branko used to say. He said, I didn't know their personality was in their blessed assurance, but that's beside the point. I can't get off track. But anyway, they corrected me and I couldn't figure out, you're inflicting pain on me. How does that benefit me? But isn't it funny when you get mature, you look back and now your perspective changes. Now you see, I'm thankful they did do it. If you're not thankful for getting it when you were a child, I'm not talking about child abuse, but I'm talking about real correction. I tell you what, if you don't believe that helped you, look at children today who's running wild and going crazy because they don't have that correction. I often say that in a supermarket. I walk up and down aisles and kids are going wild and mama's saying 10 times, don't you do that, don't you do that. You put that peanut butter, you put it. My mother would have said it one time. Second time, I would have been out over the aisle. And you wouldn't have heard from me again. That was it. That ended it for the rest of the supermarket ride. Oh, don't you get tempted? I get tempted at times. There's tempted. I want to walk up to mama and say, let me help you. I'm not trying to get off the beaten path, but I have these things coming to my mind. I was on a plane one time coming. Lacey wasn't with me. I was coming back from Africa, and we started schools over there. And I'm going to tell you something. I got to give it. I tell you, them African mothers, they don't care whose kid, they will correct it. And I don't know if you know that or not. Now, I was on a plane, and I was coming back, and we were flying from Ghana, Accra Airport. It was going back, I think, to Schiphol and in Amsterdam before I come back home. And I was on the plane. I was sitting there, and they were boarding, actually. That's how it was. They were boarding, and I was sitting there against the aisle, and there was some older mothers ahead of me, all Ghanaians practically on the plane. And they were sitting there, and here come these about three or four kids, all just yay high. They come up there, and one of them pushed the other, and they got in a tussle. And Mama was somewhere here. She didn't see this, but there was about two old African mamas sitting there. I saw this, and I mean a hand shot out, grabbed one of them kids. I thought, man, we're going to have abuse right here in front of me. What are we going to do? I mean, she grabbed one of them, and I mean, now I don't advocate saying this, but I'm just telling you, she grabbed that kid and said, hey. She said, you don't straighten up, I'll kill you. Man, them kids just stopped. Man, they just walked on. Mama come by, said, boy, Mama's going to let you, honey, have it. Mama come by, just tapped her on, just kept right on walking. She appreciated that. Boy, you do that in America, boy, you'll have a fight. Amen. Oh, man, they, huh? You'll be in jail. I tell you, you go to Africa, though, honey, they'll cheer you on. Them mamas get around and they'll help that kid out. You know, I said, wow, look at this, you know. And I almost wanted to get out there and start. Well, I said, no, I better not. But anyhow, no, I'm just kidding. But when you have none of that in your heart, I got to get a caboose on this. It's dying to self. Here we are. We're almost to the end. When you lovingly and patiently, you can bear any of those things in your life, it means that you are dying to yourself. All of these things is dying to self. Let me tell you something, folks. The greatest joy, here's another test of dying to self, is the greatest joy in your life. And I keep going back to what we talk about. And the greatest joy in your life is that your team winning the World Series or Super Bowl or anything else. That's your greatest joy. Do you get the greatest joy when you get a pay raise? Is there anything wrong with any of the things getting happy about it? No, I'm not saying that. I'm talking about priority. What is the greatest joy in your life? Let me tell you something. One of the greatest experiences that ought to produce joy in our heart more than anything else, is not a pay raise, not getting a new home, new car, not anything else but this. The greatest reaction in our heart should be this, is when we see a sinner get saved. It'd be the greatest joy in any of our lives. That there should be no greater reaction in our heart. Because why? If he's living in us, his greatest joy is when a child comes home. It is so celebrated that heaven erupts in praise and with a shout in the angels every time a child comes home to Jesus Christ. All of heaven, that tells me that the greatest celebratory response in heaven is when a soul is saved. And if I'm living in Christ and he's living in me, the greatest reaction in my life should be when a sinner is saved, I should react with the greatest joy. That means I'm dying to self. If the greatest joy is me receiving something, I'm not truly dying to myself. I should want to see others blessed more than myself. Are you hearing me here? That's the Spirit of Christ. When that is active, I know I'm rambling here this morning and can't really shut up, but I want to tell you something. Let me encourage this church. Wednesday night, my wife can tell you, we was talking in private, and I told her, I said, I want to tell you something, one of the greatest encouragements in my life, I said in ministry, happened this past Wednesday night. We almost had 50 people to a prayer meeting, a day of prayer and fasting here in this church. That was amazing, amazing turnout. And listen to this. And you knew what was happening when we was here. And this has been a dream of mine for about a year. We've been teaching here. And the church become more responsible. You become more responsible. And go around and pray for one another. Visit one another. Contact. Do these things. Pray up here for one another. And it's not just me doing it all. That's the typical American church mindset. We pay the preacher. He does it all. When all of us are to be soul winners. All of us doesn't need a title to lay hands on the sick and see something happen. We can pray for one another. Amen? And on Wednesday night, when I told you, I'm going to go out here because Lord pressed on my heart to pray for some folks that night. I said, Lacey as well. I said, if God moves in your heart, you go around and you pray for people. And I tell you, when I opened my eyes and I saw people laying hands on others, praying for others. And then at the end, Donnie was over here trying to lead two young people to Jesus Christ. Is that what was happening there, Donnie? And he was over here trying to lead these two and praying with them and leading them to Christ right here at the altar. And I wasn't nowhere around. You know why? I don't need to be there. And I said that at the end of that. I said, look at this. I said, Donnie's over here trying to lead these young people to Christ. And I said, I'm not there. I don't need to be there. Why? Because he knows how to win a soul to Christ. He don't need to call me up. Hey, would you go witness? He'll go witness. Are you hearing me? Hey, would you go witness to Aunt Bessie? No, God saved you. You go. She don't know me. She knows you. Yeah, but she knows how I act. Well, then you should have been living right. I'm telling the truth, Deborah. That's the truth, isn't it? All right. I'm going to shut up and we're going to close. But we learned something this morning, did we not? Oh, hallelujah.